Jesus, glorify. Hey, good morning. We are so glad you have joined us today for our worship time together. Thank you for visiting Forest Hill Christian Church. We hope you'll join us again soon when we're back together in person.
I found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul, to my soul. The lily of the valley, in him alone I see. All I need to cleanse and make me fully whole. In sorrow he's my comfort, in trouble he's my stay. He tells me every care on him to roll. Hallelujah, he's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul, to my soul. He'll never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me here. While I live by faith and do his blessed will, a wall of fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. With his manna he my hungry soul doth fill, soul doth fill. Then sweeping up to glory to see his blessed face, where rivers of delight shall ever roll. Hallelujah, he's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul, to my soul.
This world is not my home, I'm just a passing through. My treasures and my hope is placed beyond the blue. Many friends and kindred have gone on before, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, oh Lord, what will I do? Angels begging me to heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Over in glory land, there'll be no dying there. The saints all shouting victory and singing everywhere. I hear the voice of them who's gone on before, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, oh Lord, what will I do? Angels beckon me to heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Heaven's expecting me, that's one thing I know. I fixed it up with Jesus a long time ago. He will take me through, though I am weak and poor, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. Heaven's not my home, oh Lord, what will I do? Angels beckon me to heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. If you get there before me, I'll be there just the same. You'll hear me when I shout, oh glory to his name. I'll fly away with him, my Savior I adore, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like heaven's not my home. Oh Lord, what will I do? Angels begging me to heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore.
You are my strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I seek.
Thomas Obadiah Chisholm was born in a log cabin in Franklin, Kentucky in 1866. He received his education in a little country schoolhouse, and at age 16, he began teaching there. He became a Christian at age 27, and with no college or seminary training, he was ordained into the ministry at age 36. He served as a minister for a year or so, but ill health made it impossible for him to continue. He then moved to Vineland, New Jersey, where he opened an insurance office, of all things. Now, always interested in poetry, Chisholm wrote hundreds of poems literally during his lifetime, but he was inspired by Lamentations chapter 3, verses 22 and 23, to write the text for "Great is Thy Faithfulness." Those verses read, "Because the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for His compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. Now, Chisholm experienced that faithfulness. In fact, he suffered ill health most of his adult life and never really made much money. But he said it this way, "God has given me many wonderful displays of his providing care, which have filled me with the astonishing gratefulness." You see, Chisholm sent the words to "Great is thy faithfulness" to his friend William Runyon. And Runyon wrote the music for the hymn, and Runyon in turn was a friend of Dr. Will Houghton, the president of Moody Bible Institute in that day. And "Great is thy faithfulness" soon became one of Houghton's favorites. Dr. Houghton invited George Beverly Shea, an unknown singer at the time, to sing hymns on the Institute's radio station. Shea, of course, included Dr. Houghton's favorite hymn in his repertoire that day. Billy Graham, then a student at Wheaton College, became familiar with George Beverly Shea and this hymn through those radio broadcasts, and ultimately invited Shea to become part of his ministry, kind of as the rest of the story, if you will. And it was through their work that this hymn became popular internationally. Now, even though he suffered ill health for most of his adult life, Chisholm lived to ultimately the ripe old age of 94 years old. And during his later years, he lived in Ocean Grove, New Jersey, and lived there until his death in 1960. Now, the hymn, "Great is Thy Faithfulness," has encouraged many believers across the decades, and I want to think about the theological foundations of the hymn as well as to explore five ways that God will be faithful to you. A preacher tells the story this way. He asks the question, "Has God ever spoken to you through nature? Have you ever marveled at the faithfulness of God?" He goes on to say, I remember specifically the day when the song spoke to me. It was many years ago. I was at my mom and dad's house in Union City, Michigan," he says. "My heart was overwhelmed with the slowness of what was happening in my life. I'd been in prayer as I walked along the St. Joseph River, and it was a beautiful sun-filled day," he says. You could hear the birds, you could sense the majestic peace of nature, and as I was worshiping, the peace of God came over me. I had sat down and was watching the river, and I was watching a leaf caught in a swirl of water. Somehow this leaf was stuck, caught in a circular current, not going anywhere. And so after about 10 minutes of watching this leaf, I said to God, "God, I feel like that leaf. All the other leaves going by, and that leaf is me, Lord. When can I go and move toward my destiny?" He continues, he says, I no longer or no sooner prayed that prayer when all of a sudden the leaf broke out of the pattern and down the stream it went. He says, "In my silent meditation that day, it seemed as if the Spirit was saying to me, 'Trust me with your life, for I am faithful.' And I began to sing this hymn to the Lord that day with a renewed assurance as I trusted in Him for His timing in my life. My heart was moved as I thought about His faithfulness as I sang, 'Great is Thy faithfulness.' I felt God speaking through nature to cheer and to guide me." I want you to know today that if you have given your life to Jesus Christ, you serve a faithful God. It's interesting that the author of this hymn, "Great is Thy Faithfulness," wrote the hymn with three concepts in mind. The first concept, the Word. You see, this hymn is based first of all on Lamentations chapter 3, verse 22 and 23. "Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed. For His compassions, they never fail. They are new every morning. Great is Thy faithfulness." One of the powerful phrases of the first verse comes directly from this verse. "Great is Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not. Thy compassions, they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever wilt be." And then the chorus simply says, "Morning by morning, new mercies I see." Now, the book of Lamentations is hardly a place where you would expect to find such a scriptural gem. In fact, Jeremiah wrote this book after the destruction of Jerusalem. It's a book that describes some of the most difficult moments in all of Jewish history. Yet because Jeremiah knows God, he is able to make these kinds of declarations that God's mercies are new every morning and that his compassions fail not. As we understand what Jeremiah is saying in context to and apply it to our own life, he's saying literally that at the worst moment of your life, at the most difficult hour, God is going to be faithful. Even when things are messed up in your life, even when you have brought it on yourself like the Jews did in the book of Lamentations, God is faithful. His love and his mercy and his compassion will be renewed each day. The second concept the author used as a basis for this beautiful hymn is the unchanging nature of God. You see, verse 1 also contains these precious words: "Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not." You see, the faithfulness of God is different from the faithfulness of men. Men and women can change, but God does not change. The scripture tells us that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever, as the Hebrew writer says in chapter 13. In the Old Testament, Malachi writes, "I, the Lord, do not change." But humans can change. It is possible that an unfaithful man can become faithful. And it's also possible that a faithful man can become unfaithful. But the very nature of God is that he is unchanging. The theological word used to describe this aspect of God is that he is immutable. He will not change. There is no shadow of turning with him. This phrase comes from the New Testament book of James, chapter 1, verse 17. "Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow of turning." I don't know if you paid attention or not. Maybe you remember it from childhood, but your shadow changes length as the sun gets lower in the sky. Your shadow could be a foot long or it could be 15 feet, depending on where the sun is, right? But the immutability, if you will, of God, the unchanging nature of God, has many practical implications that encourage our faith. The same God who helped you when you were 15 will help you when you're 85. The same God who heard your grandfather's cry is the same God that will hear your grandson's cry. In other words, the unchanging nature of God translates into absolute faithfulness. And then the third concept the author used as a basis for this song is seen in nature. Since God is the creator of all that we see, his faithfulness is even seen even in a world around us. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, the songwriter penned, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. You see, the faithfulness of God is one of his invisible qualities that can be seen by the environment that he created around us. We have some friends, and their home is decorated in nearly every room with beautiful plaques and pictures and all with verses on them. And you know, without even knowing them in a personal way, just by walking through their house, you can discern an invisible quality, if you will, that they are people of the Word. It's kind of the same way with God. His invisible qualities are seen by the environment that he created. In fact, Paul writes in Romans chapter 1, as he's trying to help a world of unbelievers know who God is, he says, "Or since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse." You see, nature reveals the invisible qualities of God. The different variety of food show us the love of God for humanity. The power of a seed when it is planted and multiplies shows His generosity. All creation shows His faithfulness. And the fact is that the sun will come out tomorrow, as Annie's little song sings. The rain that falls to bring forth flowers and crops and refresh the earth shows His faithfulness. You can see His faithfulness in the way the birds get fed. You see His splendor in the Grand Canyon or a fresh fallen snow or the beauty of autumn leaves. And if you don't like the season you're in, that's okay, because the next season will be faithful to come. His faithfulness is seen in the universe. The incredible way that the planets circle the sun and the Milky Way and the orbit of the moon at night, and all of this set into motion in glorious splendor by the hand of the Creator God. I want to very quickly today give you five things that God will be faithful to do in your life. First of all, God is faithful to forgive sins when they are confessed. The final verse of the hymn says, "Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth." You see, that pardon for sin was purchased by the faithfulness of Jesus Christ. He was faithful to humble Himself, to become a man, to live a sin-free life, to go to the cross, to shed His blood, and to pay the penalty for sin. Without His faithfulness, we would not have the wonderful benefit of being forgiven. We would not have pardon for sin or a peace that endures. I, for one, am so grateful that Jesus was faithful to do what God desired. His faithfulness has produced a huge benefit for you and for me. We can be assured that when we confess our sins, pardon will be granted and forgiveness given. In fact, John writes it this way in 1 John chapter 1. He says, "If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." You see, the good news is when we first come to Christ and confess our sins, He forgives. He pardons. He accepts us, and we can become His disciples. And as life goes on, it is certain that we need to come to God and confess our shortcomings and our failings and our sins. But we can be assured that God is faithful and that He will forgive. Second thing today, God is faithful not to allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able. Paul gives us this assurance in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. "No temptation has overtaken you except such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will also make the way of escape that you may be able to bear it." This is only an encouraging scripture if you're trying to live a life that is free. You see, if you're the type of person that really doesn't care about how you live, it may feel more like this verse brings condemnation, because it says you didn't have to yield to temptation. You could have found a way of escape. But I assure you, this verse was not meant to make you feel bad or to discourage you. It was intended to show you that your faithful God is right there with you. He won't let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. The faithful God will always provide to you a way of escape. Now, escape may mean not going to certain places. Maybe it means leaving certain situations or closing your eyes or shutting off the computer or turning the TV channel or pouring it down the drain or changing jobs or whatever else is necessary. But the beautiful thing to remember is that when temptation comes, the faithful God is in the battle with you. Third thing, God is faithful to complete the work that He started in you. You may not realize this, but the moment you sincerely gave your life to Jesus Christ, God enrolled you, if you will, in His plan. His plan for you is your ultimate transformation. He desires for you to become like Jesus Christ. God's goal is that you would become mature and complete. His plan for you literally is that you would walk in victory. And here are some things for us to consider. God finishes what He starts. God didn't get halfway through creation and then give up. Rather, in 6 days he created the earth and the heavens, and on the seventh day he rested. He looked at what he did and he said, it was good. Jesus didn't go halfway to Calvary and then cast the cross aside and say, I won't complete my mission. He went all the way until he was able to utter those beautiful words on the cross, it is finished. And when he saved you, he said, I'm going to complete the work I began. The New Living Translation puts it this way in Philippians chapter 1, verse 6, and I am certain that God, who began the good work within you, will continue his work until it is finally finished on the day when Christ Jesus returns. You know, there are many believers that are in a position to say the following. I may not be all that I should be. I'm not what I used to be. I'm still under construction. God is not done with me. On the other hand, the devil would tell you, if you mess up, God doesn't love you. If you struggle, you're not his child. He'll tell you that God has left you and that you will never see heaven. But I want to tell you today, the devil is a liar. God is faithful. If he saved you, he can sanctify you. In other words, he can set you apart for his purposes. Paul writes in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, he says, now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely. And may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful, who also will do it. God will finish the work that he started in you. He will do that as you are exposed to the Word and as you receive the promptings of the Spirit. He will continue to work in your life. God has his ways to move us toward becoming like him. Now, he will chasten you, disciplining you by the consequences of your own misdeeds at times. But don't be discouraged if this happens to you. I mean, it's happened to all of us. But rather, instead, realize that you are his son or his daughter, and he is chastening you for your benefit. God will complete the work. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, beginning in verse 8, who will also confirm you to the end, that you may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, by whom you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The fourth piece I want you to see is that God is faithful to provide your needs. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Paul writes in Philippians chapter 4, my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. He's your provider. Just think of his faithfulness. He feeds the birds. He provides food for the oxen. The flowers of the field are more beautiful than Solomon in all his splendor. He is the faithful God. And I have news for you. Jesus didn't die for a sparrow, and Jesus didn't give his life for a plant. And so how much more valuable are you to him? What father or mother doesn't do all they can to provide for their children? I'll assure you that God is a faithful provider. I told you there were five things, and so here's number five. God is faithful to go with you every step of the way. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. You see, the author of this beautiful old hymn really pulled out all the stops as he wrote this last verse. He alludes to three of the most beautiful things our relationship to a faithful God provides for us. First, it provides his own presence to cheer and to guide us. We all know the theological fact, if you will, of the omnipresence of God. But that's not what the author was referring to. He's really referring to the manifested presence of God in the life of the believer, the real presence of God. And as we connect with Him on a daily basis, His hand guides our life. We sense God cheering us on. He becomes our biggest fan. He literally is telling us by His Spirit, I am with you. You'll make it to the end. And if we need guidance, God can lead us. And then the author says, strength for today. You see, God knows how to give us strength no matter what the circumstances we might be facing. I appreciate how Isaiah was led by the Lord to put it in Isaiah chapter 40, beginning in verse 28. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and His understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. And finally, the author speaks of hope for tomorrow. Yes, we have many hopes in this life that we'll get the house paid for, that we will retire, maybe we'll travel. Those are all wonderful kinds of hopes, but those hopes fade in comparison with the hope of heaven, with seeing our loved ones again. You see, God will be faithful to walk with you every step of the way. Let me close today with this story that I recently read of a successful businessman who was struck totally blind at the age of 44, prime of life. Not only was his sales ability hindered, the story goes, but his enjoyment of sports and his capacity to appreciate the great outdoors seemed to be terminated. His anger with God was intense. On one occasion, he even laid on the floor and he cried, begging God to take his life and threatening to commit suicide. It seemed as though somehow God said to him, Don, trust me. I have a great plan for your life. But still the anger and resentment lingered. A short time later, the story continues that he insisted on going for a walk. And when no one in the house was free to take him, he angrily fumbled around and he found his cane. He located the front door and against his wife's protests, he made his way down the front steps and across the yard, determined to prove something to himself and to his family. And he crossed the road and in a state of disorientation, he accidentally stumbled into a creek. And as he sat there in waist-deep water, it seemed as though God was saying to him, Are you cooled down now, Don? Trust me, I have great plans for your life. And the story says that was the moment that he entrusted himself to his faithful Creator. A few years later, he was serving the Lord effectively as a representative for a mission to the blind, finding literally more joy and satisfaction in his Christian life than he had ever known before. You see, God is faithful in sustaining us through suffering, through our hardships, through the troubles that we face. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. And that simple chorus, reassuring words, great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness. Lord, unto me.
Great is thy
Thank you again for joining us today. We hope you've been inspired, blessed, and encouraged for your week in Jesus. Would you pray with me? God, we just come into your presence and we thank you so much for your goodness. A goodness, Father, that we cannot measure. A goodness, Father, that is poured out upon us freely. A goodness, Father, that we do not deserve. Father, we come into this place and this time of prayer. We thank you for how you provide for us. And though we live in a world of fear and dismay, Father, we know that you walk with us on this journey. Father, as we go through this week, would you give us strength and courage to face the challenges before us? But more than that, Father, would you give us the hope and the assurance? Would you help us to live it out in our lives, the trust that we have in Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen.